Good afternoon. An experienced skydiver has fallen to his death on Victoria's Surf Coast after his parachute failed mid-jump. Elizabeth Moss has the details.
12 skydivers left from Torquay Airport this morning, but sadly today quickly turned tragic when one of that group crash-landed not far from here. The 34-year-old Sydenham wingsuiter crash-landed in a paddock at this Connawarri property on Brimley Road around 10:30. For some reason, his parachute didn't open and neither did his reserve. Sadly, he died at the scene.
He's an experienced skydiver that's skydived over 300 times.
He was with an instructor. That man managed to land in the same area and luckily wasn't injured, but understandably he's very shaken.
We'll be looking at the situation, all aspects of it, relation to his gear, the diving, the skydiving area, the company, etc. But that will be looked at, and hopefully in short time we'll have an answer why this occurred.
The group was jumping with the Australian Skydive Company, which told Nine News parachuting can be an inherently dangerous sport, and all our thoughts and love go out to his family and friends at this time. As to exactly what went wrong up in the air, that is what the Australian Parachute Federation will now investigate.
Australian Transport Safety Bureau investigators have begun examining the wreckage of a deadly helicopter crash in Sydney. The veteran pilot was assisting with flood recovery when the aircraft came down. More from James Wilson.
Here in the Hawkesbury, helicopter pilot Carl Herbst was known as a hero. Whether it was fires or floods, he was the man the community would call on to get them out of trouble. His life tragically ended yesterday morning during one of his countless missions, his Bell 206 long-range chopper going down in an isolated valley north of Sydney as he flew to pick up a family on their rural property isolated by floodwater.
He's a very, very giving bloke. Very generous.
One witness believes he saw a wedge-tail eagle hit the helicopter's tail rotor moments before the crash.
We do look at all of those things that may have affected the flight, and that's why we take a lot of time to go through the actual crash scene.
The 67-year-old grandfather of six was an experienced pilot of 40 years, also working as a water bombing pilot in bushfires across the state, where he was awarded a National Emergency Medal. His family today devastated by his sudden loss.
People have been telling me, yeah, he's all his accolades and that, but the best part, I think he loved being a grandfather more than anything, and that's where he shined for me.
Carl's tragic death has been felt all across this tight-knit community. An aviator, father and husband who made a living in the clouds, now flying a little higher.
Fire has torn through a home in Melbourne's inner northwest. Reporter Penelope Leish is there this afternoon. Penny, was anyone hurt in the blaze?
Alicia, normally this property is vacant, but the owner was at the property at the time that the fire took hold. He did suffer some small burns to his hands, but thankfully no one was seriously hurt. Now, it's understood that man was using an open fire to dry clothes. When they caught a light, he quickly called emergency services, but by the time firefighters arrived, the home was well engulfed, with flames shooting around 20 metres into the air here on Turner Street. There was nearly 30 firefighters deployed, and they say it was a very difficult blaze to try and control due to the close proximity of the houses on this street. You can see from the vision the flames impacting onto neighbouring properties as well. It's estimated to have caused tens of thousands of dollars to the exterior of those homes and around $500,000 damage to the weatherboard home itself. Let's take a listen to Fire Rescue Victoria about how quickly the fire took hold.
He'd gone outside. He just stepped outside for a minute, and as you can see, it only takes a short period of time for a fire to start and then cause the damage that it has done.
Now, this fire is not being treated as suspicious, but crews are likely to remain on scene here on Turner Street for quite some time this evening. We do know that Fire Rescue Victoria are using this as a warning. They're asking people to please ensure, if they are drying anything in front of heaters or open fires, to ensure they use a guard, Alicia. Set it at least a metre back to stop things catching alight.
Absolutely. Good advice. All right, Penny, thank you. Meantime, residents of a Brisbane nursing home have been left shaken after losing everything in a fire overnight. Isabel Quinlan reports.
Fire investigators have been here at Bayside Lodge Nursing Home all morning, trying to piece together just exactly what caused the blaze that ripped through this facility.
It was around 7 o'clock last night when emergency services arrived to find the western end of the lodge engulfed in flames. Thanks to the actions of quick-thinking staff, all 28 residents and their carers escaping uninjured.
It's a noteworthy point of how good a job the staff did to get people with varying age, mobility issues, disabilities out of the building.
Credit to these people who saved themselves, and then to the fireys who did an amazing job of containing that fire to stop it from spreading to all these surrounding residents.
Many of them returning with loved ones today, still in shock after losing everything.
They don't understand that they now can't come back home because home's not here anymore. And it's... and it breaks my heart.
The community is rallying together, donating clothing, bedding and other personal items for these residents.
Nick Kyrgios will have the hopes of a nation resting on his shoulders when he faces top seed Novak Djokovic in the men's final of Wimbledon later tonight. The 27-year-old kept a low profile today as he practiced on an outside court with a couple of mates and his sister. His opponent was the complete opposite, lapping up the attention. Kyrgios is the first Australian man to play in a final at the All England Club since Mark Philippoussis in 2003. His mother speaks exclusively to Nine News tonight at 6, and then our coverage starts at 10:30. Ambulance Victoria has called a seventh code red for the year after facing overwhelming demand in Melbourne overnight. The declaration was made shortly before 2 o'clock in the morning after a surge in 000 calls and lasted around 90 minutes. The organisation says around 170 paramedics are currently absent every day with COVID. Millions of Australians will now have cheaper access to potentially life-saving antiviral treatments for COVID. As Eddie Meyer explains, they're aimed at preventing a rapid rise in hospital admissions.
It's a bid to take the sting out of serious COVID-19 infections as Omicron surges to its third wave just this year. Access to the oral antiviral medications Paxlovid and Molnupiravir has been limited until now, despite the previous government ordering 1.3 million courses. That now changes.
From tomorrow will be a big expansion in access to these crucial COVID medicines that have proved so effective at reducing severe disease and relieving pressure on hospitals.
These antiviral drugs normally cost more than $1,000 a course, but those over 70 or with concession cards who test positive will now pay only $6.80 with a prescription from their GP. It's $40 for a range of others deemed at risk from this new wave of COVID-19. But with cases, deaths and hospital admissions surging across the country, pandemic leave payments won't return after ending on June 30. That despite concerns some will choose between earning money or isolating.
Turning overseas for you now, and Sri Lanka's president says he will resign amid widespread economic turmoil in the country. Furious protesters have clashed with police, leaving more than 50 people hurt. Here's correspondent Sophie Walsh.
Anarchy on the streets of Colombo. More than 100,000 protesters clashing with police and storming the presidential palace. They took over bedrooms, taking selfies, crowding onto staircases, even washing themselves in the president's pool, then moved onto the prime minister's home, setting it alight. They blame President Gotabaya Rajapaksa and his family over the mishandling of the economy, which has crippled the country, leaving millions desperate and struggling to eat. He was seen with his family boarding a ship fleeing the chaos. The country has defaulted on its foreign debt repayment and doesn't have the cash to pay for essential imports. Fuel is running out and the inflation rate of food is up more than 80%, exacerbated by COVID and the war in Ukraine. For months, Sri Lankans have been forced to queue up for hours for bare basics.
And it's time that we got all our stolen money back to this country. And also the air conditions are running in that presidential palace while people don't have electricity in their homes.
In the wake of the unrest, President Rajapaksa announced he'll resign next week, the country's prime minister agreeing to step down too. Sri Lanka's government is relying on a bailout by the International Monetary Fund, but negotiations are fraught given the nation is already bankrupt.